Good morning, everyone. First question, can everybody hear me all right?
Yes.
Good, right. That's always the good start. So, welcome to this time of praise and worship. Welcome to all of you who are here today. And welcome to all those of you who are online. And those of you who might be catching up on Facebook later. We're delighted to welcome you into the house of God, and we ask that you will, even if you're remotely connected, you will feel the presence of God as we worship today and feel blessed at the end of this service. For those of you who don't know me yet, I'm Malcolm Hayes, sometimes on that side, this time on this side. I remember a previous minister, I was saying I got promoted from this side to this side. He said, if you get more promoted, you'll end out there. But that was another story. Later, Mary Hare will be bringing us the next in our series of messages based on the parables of Jesus. The series is called Talking with Jesus. And this week, the title of the parable is Forgiveness. It's a well-known parable about an unforgiving servant, someone who was forgiven a great debt, but how they reacted is the point of the message. So a few notices. If I may be permitted, since I am the Christian Aid representative for the church, I will do a very short plug, and it will be that, for Christian Aid Week, which is this week. You've seen the thing on the notices, and there will be something in the newsletter as well. If you would like to make a donation today, then there will be envelopes like this on the back there where we put the communion offering, the offering trays, if that's the right word. So if you'd like to contribute, then please put your money in the envelope or come and see me. Or you can donate online, and the online is in the newsletter. I'd also like to, from the newsletter, draw your attention again to the prayer workshop, which will be here again this coming Friday. Don't be put off by the word workshop. It's only really if you want to think of this, it's another kind of prayer meeting. Okay, where we meet to think about prayer and pray as well. So don't be put off by the name workshop if that is putting you off. The chocolatiers, as they have become known, will be out on Christchurch Gardens / Top Park this coming Tuesday. Is that right, Fran? Tuesday, thank you, Chris. So pray for that. It's starting to bear fruit in terms of conversations. Some people coming and several times now. And it is a way of us getting out and about amongst the community, just getting our name in public. And related to that, we have the open air services, which will be coming up in June, also again on Christchurch Gardens or Top Park, depending on how old you are. It will be June the 11th, 18th and 25th. And as we said in the newsletter, we need to start praying about this, that the Spirit will move, that the right people will be brought along to hear the message. We need to prepare the ground by using the chocolatiers and possibly inviting other people we think might be receptive to the message. And lastly, we need to do all the planning as well. So no doubt somebody will be coming around, tapping you on the shoulder perhaps about taking part in these services one way and another. Right. Enough of the mechanics, should we say. Let's put aside the distractions of today, all the things baggage we've come with, all of the problems that might have happened during the week, all the distractions we might be thinking about. Put that to one side. Let's pause for a moment and be quiet. And be aware that we are in the presence of God, and that is why we are here. So, just a time of quiet. So we are here today to praise God in word and song and to hear his message to us. One of the aspects of God that we should praise him for is his great mercy. As I said in my piece in the newsletter, we're all in debt to God. We're all in a form of spiritual debtor's prison, if you want to think of it like that. And there is no hope that we can ever repay that debt of sin that we owe. But God, in his great mercy, sent his Son to pay that debt. There's no way we can do it. He had to do it for us. So that if we acknowledge Jesus as our Savior, we can be freed from this prison of sin, as you'll start to hear in one of the hymns we're going to do next. So let us come before this gracious God and praise him for his mercy to us, and praise the Lord Jesus for the love he showed in dying for us according to his Father's will. I start with a quotation from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. In him, that is Jesus, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, we praise you for the love you show to us. As the song says, such love, pure as the whitest snow, such love weeps for the shame I know, such love paying the debt I owe. O Jesus, such love. And Father, we thank you for the mercy you showed us in sending Jesus to pay the debt of sin. We ask you open our hearts and minds to receive your message for us. Amen. So we come to opening songs of worship. In case you're wondering why we have, later on you'll find that we have two bass players. It's because one of our bass, Rodrigo, has very nobly volunteered, but he's quite new, so he's going to have Laura playing along with him to give him a bit of moral support. Thank you very much, Rodrigo. But first we start with a good old standard hymn, which is And Can It Be? It's one of these things we sing quite often, and perhaps we forget just how wonderful the emotions it's expressing are. It's wonderful that the amazing love that Jesus showed to us when he died for us on the cross. So stand or sit as you feel able, And Can It Be? And can it be
that I should gain an interest in a Savior's blood, dying for me, who calls his fame, for me, who him to death pursued?
I'm going to offer a short prayer of praise. Please feel free to contribute in whatever language you find helpful or you know best. If you feel that there is a little song that you'd like us to sing, start singing and we'll try and join in with you. Jesus, we praise you that when we were locked in the dark prison of sin, through your death and resurrection, you brought light. You broke the chains that kept us in prison and set our hearts free to worship you. Amen. Our next song is, Lord, I lift your name on high. Jesus came from the glory of heaven to earth to show us the way back to God and pay the debt we owed. So lift his name on high. Our final song in this session is Filled with Compassion. It's related to the theme that Mary will be bringing as part of the message later. We have been forgiven this great debt. We know that Jesus can save us, but There are an awful lot of people out there who don't know that. And it's important that we remember that God had compassion on us. We need to have compassion on those who don't yet know that salvation. So, fill with compassion. Now, Chris, please be seated. And now, Chris will come and bring our prayers for others.
Good morning, everybody. There's so many different ways that we can pray. I feel like even in our songs that we've been singing, we have been praying. We normally include the Lord's Prayer in this time that we have. I'm actually going to be basing our prayers around the Lord's Prayer and sort of breaking it down section by section. At the end of each section, feel free to join me as I just say an amen. You'll also see that I've interspersed some psalms and some scriptures. Let us pray. Our Father who art in heaven, Lord, your word reminds us of your greatness, and we join in with the psalm. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, the one enthroned on high? He humbles himself to behold the heavens and the earth. Amen.
Amen.
Hallowed be your name. Father God, this morning we recognize that you are Lord and your name is great, and that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that you are Lord. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Young men and maidens, old and young together, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His splendor is above the earth and the heavens. Amen.
Amen.
Your kingdom come. Lord, we live in a world full of the kingdoms of men. Many of these kingdoms are at war with each other, and true peace eludes mankind. But you have promised us your kingdom, a kingdom where love, justice, peace, and glory will shine. You have also promised that with the new birth, your kingdom shall reign in our hearts as we live in this world, but not of this world. May your kingdom come in us. Amen.
Amen.
Your will be done on earth as in heaven. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and all who dwell therein. Lord, we do not know your entire will, but you have told us in your word what is right, what is proper, and what you desire of mankind. Lord, help us to be your hands and your feet as we overcome our weaknesses and serve each other and the communities in which we live. Your will, you said, is that none should be lost. Help us to do our part in sharing the gospel of your Son with those who do not know you. Amen. Give us today our daily bread. Jesus said, "And when you pray, do not babble on like pagans, for they think that by their many words they will be heard. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you even ask him. And so, Lord, you know our needs, the needs of every person here, of every person who belongs to this fellowship. We pray for guidance, strength, healing, and grace according to our needs and according to their needs. We pray specifically for the search team as they continue to search for a minister who will lead us. We pray for our school children who will soon be embarking on important examinations. Lord, we just pray that you be with them, that you help them in all of their studies. We pray for our country, and we pray for this troubled world in which we live. Send your power, Lord, and save us. Amen. Forgive us our sins. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his loving kindness towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Just as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. Lord, we fear you not because you will ever harm us, but because you alone are holy, and you require us to be holy, and yet we fall short. Thank you, Lord, that through the blood of your Son, our sins can be forgiven, and you can look upon us, even us, as holy. Amen. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lord, today we will be learning about the unforgiving servant. Help us to not be like that. When we are ourselves are being forgiven for so much, help us to treat each other with grace and forgiveness. Help us to let go of grudges and bitterness towards our brothers and our sisters, so that we ourselves can be free. Amen. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lord, we pray that you keep us out of harm's way. Help us to be faithful to you, to resist temptation, and to put on the mind of Christ in all things. Amen. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
So as preparation for the message which Chris has alluded to, the unforgiving servant, we're going to sing, Let There Be Love Shared Among Us. Think about the words as you sing them, because I think you'll find that Mary's message is going to echo some of these themes. We're going to sing it through twice. Let there be love shared among us. Please stand. Please be seated. And now Jean will come and bring us the message. And after that, we shall hear from Mary, internet permitting.
This morning's reading is taken from Matthew Chapter 18, reading from verses 21 to 35, and can be found in the Bibles in the seats on page 17 in the New Testament. Matthew chapter 18, reading from verse 21. Then Peter came to him and asked, "Lord, how often am I to forgive my brother if he goes on wronging me?" "As many as 7 times." Jesus replied, "I do not say 7 times, but 70 times 7. The kingdom of heaven, therefore, should be thought of in this way. There was once a king who decided to settle accounts with the men who served him. At the outset, there appeared before him a man who owed 10,000 talents. Since he had no means of paying, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife, his children, and everything he had to meet the debt. The man fell at his master's feet. 'Be patient with me,' he implored, "and I will pay you in full." And the master was so moved with pity that he let the man go and cancelled the debt. But no sooner had the man gone out than he met a fellow servant who owed him 100 denarii. He took hold of him, seizing him by the throat, and said, "Pay me what you owe." The man fell at his fellow servant's feet and begged him, "Be patient with me, and I will pay you." But he refused and had him thrown into jail until he should pay the debt. The other servants were deeply distressed when they saw what had happened, and they went to their master and told him the whole story. Then he sent for the man and said, "You scoundrel, I cancelled the whole of your debt when you appealed to me. Ought you not to have shown mercy to your fellow servant, just as I showed mercy to you?" And so angry was the master that he condemned the man to be tortured until he should pay the debt in full. That is how my heavenly Father will deal with you, unless you each forgive your brother from your hearts. May God add his blessing to this word.
Thank you very much, Jean, for bringing God's word to us. And it's a great privilege to be with you again this morning. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We could paraphrase this: blessed are those who humbly recognize their need for God, for they will enter into his kingdom. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are those who mourn for their sins, for they shall receive forgiveness and life eternal. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are those who show mercy through forgiveness, kindness, and compassion, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who have been reconciled to God through Jesus Christ and bring this same message of reconciliation to others. All who have peace with God are his children. Why do I start with the Beatitudes from the Sermon on the Mount in the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 5, you may ask? Certainly, we have read a passage from Matthew chapter 18 about a forgiving person and an unforgiving person rather than the Sermon on the Mount. But both of these passages are about attitudes, whether God's attitude to us or our attitude to God and to each other. They are about relationships and the importance of these to us all. They are about our Christian lives and what it means to be a child of the kingdom of God. I believe that we can learn a lot from the Beatitudes, as Jesus in his Sermon on the Mount established a new basis for our lives and for our relationships. And he echoed this in the parable of the unforgiving servant. Let us today really try to examine our attitudes and what this shows about our relationships with God and the kingdom of God. The coronation of King Charles is still fresh in our minds, and so I really had to take some elements or thoughts arising from this service and also from the late Queen Elizabeth II, whose own words coming from her own deep faith have resonated both in her life and after her death. Queen Elizabeth II said in the Christmas message of 2011, God sent into the world a unique person, neither a philosopher nor a general, important though they are, but a savior with the power to forgive. Forgiveness lies at the heart of the Christian faith. It can heal broken families. It can restore friendships. And it can reconcile divided communities. It is in forgiveness that we feel the power of God's love. I might add blessing to the word power. It is in forgiveness that we feel the power and the blessing of God's love. At the coronation service of King Charles III, the Archbishop of Canterbury preached on the words from Luke chapter 4, where Jesus commences his ministry in the synagogue at Nazareth by declaring the true nature of the kingdom of God, what his ministry will be and for whom, the marginalized, the outcast, and the oppressed. In Matthew's gospel, we have the Beatitudes to learn about the kingdom of God, a whole new basis for our lives, with relationships grounded in love, acceptance, forgiveness, and respect. The Beatitudes help us to understand the magnitude of God's grace and its power to change our lives, and where true blessing or true happiness can be found. Both the Beatitudes and the parable of Jesus, which we read today, highlight the struggle we experience every day between the values of God's kingdom and our human tendencies to feel we are in control, to be manipulative and divisive. In other words, our temptations not to follow Jesus. The Archbishop of Canterbury said in his sermon on the 6th of May, speaking of the kingdom of God, the kingdom sets the aims of all righteous government, all authority. And the kingdom also sets the means of all government and authority. For Jesus doesn't grasp power or hold onto status. I think that these words from the Archbishop are important. God did not hold onto status in bringing in his kingdom. He did it rather through sacrifice, emptying himself, even to dying on the cross. In the parable which we read today, Jesus says, "The kingdom of heaven is like this," and tells a story taken from everyday life, but with a meaningful exaggeration. A servant owed his king a massive amount of money. 10,000 talents. When each talent was around 6,000 denarii, a day's living wage. At this rate, it would take the servant 200,000 years to earn such a sum and repay the debt. There are other calculations, but the point is that it is a ridiculous sum which no one, not even Elon Musk, could pay back. If the servant could not do it, all his family would be sold into slavery and his possessions sold to meet the debt. Malcolm reminded us of the debtor's prison in Dickens' time, and also the massive debts which countries have, especially developing countries, with seemingly no way of repaying. Yet in this parable, the servant fell on his knees before the king and begged patience, whereupon the king released him and forgave the whole massive debt. We know that God's forgiveness of us and our sins is massive, unfathomable, incalculable, and even outrageous. This part of the story really brings home to us how great our debt to God is because of our sin. Just like the servant's debt, which being of massive size could never be paid back. The just punishment for our sin was death, but our release and our forgiveness from this sin is eternal life. As Paul says in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The unexpected, unfathomable way in which God brings forgiveness of our sins and justifies us is told in this parable. And also in the interpretation which I prefer, is echoed in the parable of the dishonest manager, or shrewd manager, as it is sometimes called, from Luke's Gospel, chapter 16. The manager there had been dismissed, but forgave his master's debts in an unauthorized way. Jesus was sent or approved by his father to seek out the sinners, those considered unworthy, and forgive debts or sins in a most unexpected and unorthodox way on the cross, where God's true love for us was revealed. This amazing act justifies us, the sinful ones, reconciles us to God when we repent and when we believe in him. This is the absolute mind-blowing and unexpected nature of undeserved grace. Our sins forgiven by the initiative of God, not by our works. As just like the servant who could not repay his debt and was to be thrown into prison, so we would die too without God's forgiveness and love. This part of the parable is mind-blowing. But the second part is equally mind-blowing and definitely disturbing for us. For the servant who has been forgiven goes out and meets someone who owed him a small amount, but did not forgive him his debt, instead having him thrown in jail. The Good News Bible describes the large debt forgiven by the king as millions of pounds, which now would be billions of pounds, and the small debt owed to the forgiven servant as a few pounds. The contrast of attitudes and actions could not be greater, emphasized by the difference in debts. When the king heard about the servant's action, his lack of forgiveness, he called him in and told him in no uncertain terms that he should have had mercy on the debtor after receiving such amazing forgiveness of his own massive debt. The result of this unseeing servant's actions towards his fellow servant was punishment and captivity to his debt forever, as he would be unable to repay it. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you, if you do not forgive your brother or sister from the heart, finishes Jesus' words at the end of the parable. A clear message that we must forgive just as our Father God forgives us. If not, we shall remain captive to our own sin. The debt which is ours through our sin is enormous, the monetary amount in the story exaggerated to illustrate the enormity of the sin. Similarly, our obligation to be forgiving to others as a reflection of God's love is emphasized in the answer to Peter's question to Jesus, "How often should I forgive? As many as 7 times. "No," said Jesus, 77 times. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 13 states, "Bear with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony." We are commanded to forgive those who do wrong to us, not just those who are asking for forgiveness, or those who have offended us once, or whose wrongs seem forgivable. Although this is set within the church's community, we can apply these words throughout all of our relationships. In the Lord's Prayer, receiving forgiveness from God is joined to forgiving others. "And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors." The teachings in the Lord's Prayer and the parable we read do not teach that our future, our promise of eternal life, is based on our forgiving other people. However, it does teach that our relationship with God will be damaged if we refuse to pardon those who have offended us. The Bible is clear that God pardons sin by his grace based on Christ's work on the cross alone, not on any person's actions. However, even if we accept that act of grace by God, we need day-to-day cleansing as we confess our sins in order to restore the fellowship which is interrupted by the daily effects of sin. Asking for God's forgiveness for one's own sins on a daily basis, while all the while withholding forgiveness from someone else, is not only bizarre, but hypocritical. We cannot possibly walk with God in true fellowship if we refuse to forgive others. Additionally, it is difficult to believe that anyone who holds on to unforgiveness against others has truly understood or experienced God's forgiveness. This is where our understanding of Matthew's Beatitudes is helpful. We are already blessed in our knowledge and acceptance by faith of Jesus and his saving grace. But there is still more blessing to come if we can show forth the nature of the kingdom of God by being humble, vulnerable, and by being forgiving and merciful. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Forgiveness to others, our love to others through forgiveness, is the characteristic of the kingdom of God and the character of a Christian. We should forgive others because God, through Christ, has forgiven us. It is wrong for someone who has truly experienced God's forgiveness to refuse to grant forgiveness to others. For God's forgiveness is much more than a judicial release from debt. It is the outflow of redeeming love that transforms the heart. Forgiveness is obedience to God's command and brings blessing as we become children of the kingdom of God. In John chapter 14 and verse 15, Jesus says to his disciples, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." And he also promises his Holy Spirit to abide in us and help us keep these commandments, even when forgiving and loving is very difficult. But we know also that resentment is a very unhealthy emotion. It hurts us far more than those who have wronged us. Hebrews chapter 12 says, "Aim at peace with everyone. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble." The wrongs which have happened on a corporate or a national scale are also incalculable, and reconciliation between peoples affected is extraordinarily challenging. At the time of the coronation, Indigenous peoples from 12 countries wrote to King Charles II asking that he apologize to First Nations people and compensate them for the disastrous effects of colonization. The trauma which many First Nations people experienced and experience to this day, and the possible means of reconciliation and reparation, was discussed at length on broadcasts in Australia leading up to the broadcast of the coronation service. Certainly, forgiveness is costly, both to those who forgive and those who are forgiven. Those who need forgiveness have to acknowledge this need. This is especially so on the corporate level. Some colleagues here have said to me, "Why should we keep apologizing and give compensation for what our ancestors did to Aboriginal people? It wasn't us." Yet the effects are palpable today amongst Aboriginal people who suffer the effects of colonization and misguided policies of the past, as they do in other countries like Canada. Members of the royal family have expressed regret in recent months for their historical links to the slave trade. All these matters will bring many challenges in forgiveness and reconciliation in coming years. As we now pray for wisdom for King Charles in reconciliation movements to come, and as we pray for our own strength in forgiveness of those with whom we are connected, either in our Christian community or elsewhere, let us remember the late Queen's example of forgiveness in this 25th year of the Good Friday Agreement in Northern Ireland. In 2011, Queen Elizabeth visited the Republic of Ireland, the first British monarch to visit in 100 years. She bowed her head in respect to those who died for Irish independence after laying a wreath at the Garden of Remembrance in Dublin. This was an act of forgiveness by the Queen, who knew that she was honouring those who inspired the murderers of Prince Philip's uncle, Earl Mountbatten of Burma, in 1979, killed by the IRA. A year after her visit to Ireland, the Queen met and shook the hand of a former IRA commander and then Deputy First Minister of Northern Ireland, the late Martin McGuinness, in Belfast. In a moment, we shall sing again as a response to our scripture today, "Let there be love shared among us." And we shall also give thanks for God releasing us from our sin in the song, The Power of the Cross. Let us also remember the Queen's words. It is in forgiveness that we feel the power of God's love. May this love and our forgiving love for each other be a blessing to us all today and in the days to come. And as Chris was saying in his prayers, may your kingdom come in us. Amen.
So as Mary was saying, let's consider for a moment what that message means to us each personally. Perhaps there is someone we've been harboring resentment against whom we need to go and forgive. I don't know. But let's be quiet for a moment, think about that. And then as a way of reinforcing that, we're going to do Let There Be Love Shared Among Us, just the once. So let's have a time of quiet. Let there be love shared among us. We finish with a song of triumph. We normally sing this song at Easter, but it's perfectly acceptable to sing it now as well. It's a celebration, as Mary was saying earlier, of the power of the cross, recognizing the great love that Jesus paid, the great price that he paid to free us from the debt of sin. What a love! What a cost. We stand forgiven at the cross. Oh, to see the dawn.
Oh,
Lord, we praise you that you have forgiven us the debt that we owe to you for our sins, a debt we can never repay. As we go forward into this week, help us to be not like the unforgiving service, but to give others as we are forgiven. Help us to make this church a place where all are welcome and all can come and receive the forgiveness and love of God. Let's finish by saying the grace to each other. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.